Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the United States Central Command Change of Command Ceremony. I am Lieutenant Colonel Laura King, your narrator for today's event. The presiding officials for today's ceremony are the Secretary of Defense, the Honorable Ashton B. Carter, and the 19th Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Joseph F. Dunford, Jr. Today, General Lloyd J. Austin III, Commander, United States Central Command, will relinquish command to General Joseph L. Votel. We are honored to have with us our special guests, representatives of many nations with which we are proud to partner within the Levant, Arabian Peninsula, and South and Central Asia. We would also like to welcome members of the Diplomatic Corps, interagency, and senior leaders of the federal, military, and civilian community. We'd also like to welcome our beloved Centcom families, who truly carry the heaviest load and enable us to do the important work we do. At this time, in lieu of the traditional flower presentation to Mrs. Austin and Mrs. Votel, the soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, Coast Guardsmen, and outstanding civilian workforce of the United States Central Command have elected to make a small charitable donation to a wounded warrior organization on their behalf. It is meant as a symbolic gesture to represent their continued concern and influence for our military service members and their families. Providing the music today for this ceremony is the 82nd Airborne Division Band under the direction of Chief Warrant Officer Robert Bruns. Lastly, we have the men and women of the United States Central Command represented by the formation before you, led by Sergeant Major William R. Hambrick, Jr., the Senior Enlisted Leader for Central Command's Operations Directorate. Bearing the U.S. Central Command colors is Gunnery Sergeant Roque Perez, and the non-commissioned officers in charge for each of the components are United States Army, Sergeant Major Henry Montoya, United States Marine Corps, Master Gunnery Sergeant Sean Schaffner, United States Navy, Master Chief Petty Officer Nathaniel Carlin, and United States Air Force, Chief Master Sergeant Eric Foreman. Please give them a round of applause. The United States Central Command was established in 1983 and is responsible for military operations in a region consisting of 20 countries in the Levant, Arabian Peninsula, and Central and South Asia, including the waters of the Red Sea, the Arabian Gulf, and Indian Ocean. Throughout its history, Central Command has deployed combat forces to Southwest Asia and the Horn of Africa on a number of occasions to deter our enemies, assure our friends, and maintain stability in a critical region of the world. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for the arrival of the official party and remain standing for the rendering of honors, the singing of our national anthem by Petty Officer First Class Alex Kuhn, and the invocation delivered by the U.S. Central Command Chaplain, Colonel Jeffrey D. Waters. Moving on to the stage are the Honorable Ashton B. Carter, Secretary of Defense, General Joseph F. Dunford, Jr., Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Lloyd J. Austin III, Commander, United States Central Command, and General Joseph L. Votel, the incoming commander.
say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the
Please join me in prayer. Oh Lord, today we give thanks for General and Mrs. Austin, and we stand in the shadow of their legacy. We thank you for Mrs. Austin and her steadfast commitment to the service members, their families, and to this community. We thank you for the privilege of serving under General Austin. Thank you for his integrity, his wisdom, and his ability to defend and promote freedom around the world. We pray that you would continue to guide General and Mrs. Austin in the days ahead as they take on new challenges and responsibilities. In a moment, the colors will pass and a new page will begin in CENTCOM history. We pray for General and Mrs. Votel as they embark on this new adventure. Guide and direct General Votel as he shoulders the weight of command. Bless him with keen insight and wisdom as he tackles the most difficult and hard-pressed issues that face our nation and our world. We pray that you would impede evil, reward the good, and promote those who promote freedom. Bless the entire CENTCOM and Coalition family, and we ask these things in your name. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. The change of command is a traditional event. Key to the ceremony is the passing of the colors. The colors are the commander's symbol of authority, representing his responsibilities to the organization. The passing of colors symbolizes the transfer of command, responsibility, and authority from the old commander to the new commander. The United States Central Command Senior Enlisted Leader, Command Sergeant Major Christopher K. Greca, is the custodian of the colors. When the colors are not displayed for the commander, they are in the care of the command's Senior Enlisted Leader. By the authority of the President and the Congress of the United States of America, General Joseph L. Votel, United States Army, assumes command of United States Central Command, effective 30 March 2016. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce the presiding officer for today's ceremony, the Secretary of Defense of the United States, the Honorable Ashton B. Carter.
Good afternoon, everyone. Just before we get started, just take a moment to look at those men and women in front of us, so magnificent and so proud, and what they stand for, which is many, many, many more behind them. You all look absolutely fabulous. We're so proud of you. Many distinguished guests, elected officials, members of the CENTCOM team, friends, family, it's an honor to be with you as we honor two great Americans and their families. Today, we pass the torch between two of our military's most distinguished officers, between two leaders whose selfless dedication and service are emblematic of this command and its people, between General Lloyd Austin and General Joe Votel. But before I speak to the qualities and accomplishments of two extraordinary leaders, I want to speak directly to you, all the men and women of CENTCOM, for what you do today and every day to protect America's interests in a troubled region, to keep our country and people safe. For that, thank you. As you coordinate the operations of your brothers and sisters who serve 8, 9, or 10 time zones away, many of you, I know, keep the same hours. For some of you, it can be dark when you get to work and dark when you get home. I know that serving here at CENTCOM demands a lot from you and your families, and I want you and them to know how grateful I am, how grateful this country is for what you do on many fronts, and particularly in the campaign to defeat ISIL. I outlined our counter-ISIL campaign when I spoke earlier this year at CENTCOM. Alongside Chairman Dunford, General Austin, and General Votel, I described then the three central objectives of that campaign. First, to destroy the ISIL parent tumor in Iraq and Syria and collapse its two power centers in Raqqa and Mosul. Second, to combat the metastases of ISIL worldwide. And third, to protect our homeland. One of the leaders we celebrate today put a finer point on our mission. General Austin said at that time, quote, "We've got to keep our dukes up." In your work across the U.S. government and with partners across the world, you've helped us do just that by creating and exploiting and ever-expanding opportunities to attack ISIL, with additional training and assistance for local forces to take and hold territory, and with support from coalition partners, we're continuing to gather momentum, and we will deliver ISIL a lasting defeat. In recent months, Iraqis trained and supported by the U.S.-led coalition have consolidated their gains around Ramadi. They're reclaiming further territory in Anbar province. In Syria, capable local forces supported by the U.S. and our global coalition have retaken the eastern Syrian town of Shaddadi, helping to sever the last major northern artery between Raqqa and Mosul. Meanwhile, 90% of our military coalition partners have committed to increasing contributions to also help defeat ISIL. We've increased our strikes on ISIL's oil enterprise and cash depots. We've removed top ISIL leaders from the battlefield and conducted targeted strikes in Libya as well. Of course, your work at CENTCOM extends well beyond one threat or even one critical campaign. From your continued support of our ongoing mission to support the Afghan people in their pursuit of a secure and prosperous future, to your constant efforts to deny al-Qaeda and other violent extremists a safe haven, to your support for efforts to counter Iran's malign influence in the region, CENTCOM continues to address some of our nation's most vital national security interests. Now, over the past 3 years, the people of CENTCOM have met these challenges under the extraordinary leadership of a towering figure in the life of our military, General Lloyd Austin. Now, it's one of the highest compliments in the Army to be called a soldier's soldier, and for more than four decades, Lloyd Austin has not only demonstrated what it means to be a soldier's soldier, he's come to define it. Through gallantry on the battlefield, which earned him a Silver Star, through the courage he has inspired among his troops, and through his quiet, confident determination to see every mission through, Lloyd will be remembered among this generation's most accomplished soldiers, statesmen, and strategists. And to think, when Lloyd arrived at West Point in the 1970s, he had a simple plan. He would finish his service obligation and then attend law school. Now think about that. Lloyd is your lawyer. I think it would depend on what the crime was, how that worked out. But truth be told, Lloyd, you might be starting a little late. There's still time. But of course, in the years that followed West Point, Lloyd showed a remarkable knack for leadership in the Army. As Lloyd rose through the ranks, he excelled as a leader within some of the Army's most celebrated institutions, whether during his time with the 10th Mountain, the 82nd Airborne, or the 18th Airborne Corps. Lloyd left an imprint and a legacy on all he served. But not even a leader of Lloyd's foresight could have anticipated how much the country would ask of him and his family over these past 15 years. Over a period of time when we've asked so much from our troops and their families, few military leaders have given more, seen more, and accomplished more than Lloyd Austin. His actions in 2003, leading the 3rd Infantry Division into Baghdad, helped to capture the indomitable spirit and inspiring leadership that has defined his entire career. One of Lloyd's soldiers, then Sergeant Demetrius Johnson, once described the situation to a journalist, and I quote, "There were units running low on ammo, visibility was low, and the enemy was closing in. You could hear a lot of uncertainty in the voices of commanders on the radio." But amid the sound and fury of that day, amid one of the largest infantry maneuvers in recent history, there was a powerful voice of calm at the center, that of then Brigadier General Lloyd Austin. Rather than leading operations from afar, he led from the front. Lloyd insisted that his command be nimble enough and close enough to the center of the fight. Rather than raising his voice or shouting commands from behind the line, Lloyd took command of a complex, fluid, and dangerous environment with complete composure. As Master Sergeant Johnson explained, and I quote, "When you heard him, you got a sense of calm and peace. You trusted him. Everyone he comes in contact with trusts him," end quote. And it's because of his quiet confidence, and above all, the confidence it inspires, and because of his complete candor, that General Austin has earned the trust of so many, not within only within our military or our government, but there, including with their deep appreciation, this Secretary of Defense and the President, but also across the world. His patient insights, his powerful intellect, and his undeniable presence have developed deep bonds of trust. And it is upon this foundation that Lloyd has helped to build a formidable military coalition now taking the fight to ISIL. While few military leaders have overseen operations of greater complexity than General Austin, he's described a measure for success that is both simple and profound. General Austin's ultimate objective, I quote him, is to be loved by his family, respected by his peers, feared by his enemies. Lloyd, on all three accounts, you've accomplished your mission. Your four decades of selfless service are a tribute to your personal integrity, to the force you have served so nobly, and to the country you love so deeply. Lloyd, on behalf of the Department of Defense and grateful nation, we thank you. And I also want to thank your partner and inspiration, your lovely wife, Charlene, for the tremendous support. For the tremendous support that she has provided, not only to you, but the people and families of CENTCOM and so many who have served under your command. Charlene, you've sacrificed greatly over these many years, and we owe you and your entire family a tremendous debt of gratitude. I know that you're looking forward to spending some more time with your husband, and we in the DoD family, to include Stephanie and me, wish your family the very best of luck. Earlier today, I spoke about the distinguished leader who will assume General Austin's command, General Joe Votel. As different as their two careers have been, both General Austin and General Votel share a common foundation. These are two men who know what it means to be servant leaders and soldier statesmen. As I said earlier today, I recommended General Votel to President Obama to lead CENTCOM for three central reasons. Reasons that are plainly evident when you look at his extraordinary leadership. First, Joe has extensive experience with all elements of the joint force, air, sea, ground, of course special operations, but also cyber and space. This joint experience, and importantly trans-regional experience, has provided him the perspective and authority to lead the enormous and varied forces America brings to bear in CENTCOM. Within SOCOM itself, his clear and creative problem solving, from personnel and leadership issues to acquisition and, of course, operations, is something that I have come to consult myself again and again as I approach broader challenges in DoD. Now, second, General Votel has extensive experience and deep understanding of CENTCOM's area of responsibility, its history, its challenges. And third, over these past 19 months, Joe has forged difficult consensus and cemented strong partnerships with many of his regional counterparts. His politico-military skill and strength as a warrior diplomat make him the perfect fit to be the next CENTCOM commander, a command where our partners matter so much and our partnerships run so deep. Joe Votel and Lloyd Austin are two accomplished generals, but at their core, they're two devoted Americans who have demonstrated unwavering dedication to our mission, to the military and to its people, and to the security of this great country. Across their careers, both men have demonstrated what can be described as inherent resolve. It's fitting, then, that as we mark the change of command between these two leaders, that we introduce today the Inherent Resolve Campaign Medal. I'm pleased to announce today, by the President's order and upon the Chairman's and my recommendation, that our sailors, soldiers, airmen, and Marines serving in Iraq and Syria as part of Operation Inherent Resolve are eligible for this medal and distinction. As we continue to accelerate our counter-ISIL campaign, we will continue to depend on the men and women of CENTCOM. It is you who provide us the flexibility to respond to any threat across this critical region. It is you who provide our partners the fortitude to reclaim their lands, their lives, and their future. And in General Joe Votel, you have a rare leader with the capabilities and experience to carry forward the mission General Austin has led so capably. So today, as we mark this change of command at CENTCOM between two proven statesmen, joint force warriors, coalition builders, we also celebrate a remarkable continuity. These two men have led on different battlefields, but they both understand the powerful responsibility of asking our young people to enter extreme danger to accomplish a vital mission. These are two leaders who appreciate deeply the weight of all we ask our troops and their families to carry. We cannot predict precisely how or when the men and women of CENTCOM will be called to carry forward their mission in the months and years to come. But we do know this. We know General Votel will lead this team with certainty, clarity, and with the total trust and confidence of me and the President. We know that as our military protects our nation and people, and as our country helps provide security for men and women across the world, to live full lives, to dream their dreams, to raise their children, CENTCOM's efforts will remain essential. And this we know with absolute certainty. The force General Votel inherits is ready to execute its vital responsibilities, thanks to General Austin's remarkable leadership. To General Austin, to General Votel, to all the men and women who have served under their strong and steady leadership, thank you.
Thank you, Secretary Carter. Ladies and gentlemen, the 19th Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Joseph F. Dunford, Jr.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, and most of all to the men and women of the United States Central Command, it's an honor to be here today as we mark the transfer of authority and responsibility from General Lloyd Austin to General Joe Votel. As I mentioned earlier this morning at the Special Operations Chain of Command, days like today are really more about continuity than they are about change. We're changing leadership at the Central Command, but the men and women in the command will remain in the attack, and they're not going to miss a beat in the performance of their mission. Today, we talk a lot about the complexity and volatility of the security environment, and for our geographic combatant commands, there's no shortage of demanding challenges. But there is no other geographic combatant command that has been asked to do more, and no other combatant command that has done more over the last several years than the United States Central Command. To the members of the CENTCOM team, I want you to know that your contributions have been recognized and appreciated. I know you recognize that from the Secretary's remarks. We've asked a lot of you, and you've delivered. And I'd like to quickly take the opportunity to highlight some of your accomplishments. As General Austin says, what you do at CENTCOM is hard government work. When you're responsible for part of the world that consists of places like Iraq, Syria, Iran, Yemen, Egypt, Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Lebanon, you never know what kind of crisis or challenge you're going to wake up to in the morning. But to bring all that to life, a typical day in CENTCOM involves conducting strikes against ISIL leadership and resources, supporting partners on the ground in Iraq, Syria, Afghanistan, and Yemen, in conducting naval operations in the Gulf to ensure freedom of navigation. It involves conducting multilateral exercises to improve our interoperability and develop the capacity of partners in a region that spans from Egypt to Pakistan. And while the CENTCOM team is doing all that, they're planning for a wide range of other crises and contingencies across the area of responsibility. If you're on the CENTCOM team, the days are long and busy, and that's typically 6 or 7 days a week. But it's not so much what CENTCOM does that's remarkable, it's how they do it. I don't believe I'd get much of an argument if I said that the current fight against ISIL in Iraq and Syria is as complex as any fight we've ever had, militarily or politically. It was just a few months ago, there was little good news, and all the pundits were saying that all was lost. But fortunately, the CENTCOM team wasn't listening. They were too busy developing ways to push back on the enemy and gain momentum. They were too busy developing and maintaining a coalition of over 60 nations. They were too busy fighting for intelligence, improving the targeting process, and building the capacity of our partners. They were too busy incorporating lessons learned during the first year of the fight and making the necessary adjustments to win. And today, while much work remains to be done, the dialogue about ISIL in Iraq and Syria is much different. Today, we talk about coalition forces having a momentum. We talk about the effects of over 11,000 strikes that have killed key ISIL leaders, degraded their command and control, limited their freedom of movement, and significantly reduced their resources. Today we talk about the fact that more than 40% of ISIL-held ground in Iraq has been retaken by Iraqi security forces and the Peshmerga. We talk about indigenous forces in Syria retaking 18,000 square miles. And we're able to say all that as a direct result of the commitment, the professionalism, the competence, and the courage of the soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines of the United States Central Command. When many others were wringing their hands on the sidelines, the CENTCOM team simply tightened their chin straps and drove on, and the results speak for themselves. While ISIL dominates the headlines, it's just one of the many tasks for the CENTCOM team, as the Secretary has addressed. Last year alone, CENTCOM executed more than 50 bilateral and multilateral exercises, consisting of naval, air, and land assets from 14 partner nations. CENTCOM continues to oversee the fight in Afghanistan. We maintain a coalition of 14,000 NATO forces, which includes 10,000 U.S. forces. And over the past 3 years, CENTCOM planned and executed a drawdown of over 100,000 forces and a number in hundreds of forward operating bases and combat outposts. And I believe that's an operational logistical feat that will be studied in the classrooms for many years to come. CENTCOM is also providing support to the Saudi-led coalition in Yemen to support a partner and check the influence of al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula. And every day, CENTCOM is taking action to counter Iran's malign influence, to include bolstering the capabilities of partners in the region. And all that is simply an overview of the heavy lifting that goes on here in Tampa and across the CENTCOM area of responsibility every day. For the last 3 years, the extraordinary performance of the United States Central Command has been a direct reflection of the extraordinary leadership of General Lloyd Austin. I've known General Austin for over 17 years. 13 years ago this week, he was on my flank in combat. He's been a role model, a mentor, a boss, a friend, and occasionally, and Lloyd, you remember this, when I was working for you in Afghanistan, you've been my chaplain. For me, Lloyd Austin is the epitome of a military leader, humble, selfless, courageous, and committed. As someone recently said, Lloyd Austin has earned a reputation as someone people want to follow into battle. For the last 3 years, he's been an inspiration to the thousands of men and women of the Central Command operating under the most challenging of circumstances. But what he has done at CENTCOM is simply another chapter in the 40-year career of a soldier who has lived by the West Point motto, duty, honor, country. As he completes his last assignment, he leaves behind a legion of men and women, and I'd include Joe Dunford in that category, who are proud to be Lloyd Austin trained. Now, everything I just said is sincere, it comes from the heart, but Lloyd is not actually my favorite Austin. I want to recognize his wife, Charlene, who's been with him every step of the way and a passionate advocate for military families. Charlene, thanks for your extraordinary sacrifice and support, and I would tell you that Ellen and I are proud to call you a friend. Fortunately for CENTCOM and the nation, we don't have to look far to find another superb leader to take the helm at CENTCOM. General Votel, as the Secretary said, knows the mission, he knows the region, and he has the experience and the credibility to take the command forward. When it came time for the Secretary to pick Lloyd's replacement, as we heard a minute ago, it was a pretty short conversation. We knew this was one of the most demanding assignments in our military at a very critical time. And that one, that required a special leader. And we have that leader in Joe Votel. And once again, to Michelle, Scott, and Nick, thanks for your sacrifice and support. And Michelle, to you in particular, you know, at times like this, many people say congratulations. And Ellen and I have come to say more often thank you than congratulations, because we appreciate that it is a rare opportunity to have command, especially at something like the United States Central Command, but we're also mindful of the extraordinary sacrifice that a family makes when someone like Joe assumes these responsibilities. And we know that couldn't have happened without a conversation that took place probably over a glass of wine late one night when he said, hey, this is what's going on, and can I? And thanks for saying yes. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, it's an honor to be here to thank General Austin for his service and mark the transfer of authority to General Votel. And now it's my distinct honor to introduce my friend, a warrior, a leader, and at the end of the day, someone who defines what it means to be a soldier, General Lloyd Austin.
At the outset, I'd like to thank the band and the color guard, and of course, these magnificent troops that are arrayed in front of us. You all look wonderful. You honor us with your presence. And I'm struck by the fact that we have the famed 82nd Airborne Division band here playing for us today. So let's give them a round of applause. You know, I stood in this same spot some 3 years ago on the 22nd of March, 2013, after assuming command of CENTCOM. And I want to say up front that it has been the greatest honor and privilege of my life to be a part of this magnificent team and to have led it during what has proven to be one of the most challenging and tumultuous periods in its history. This command and the great men and women of this command make the impossible possible every single day. They are tireless, selfless patriots, and I could not be more proud of them and proud of their families. Secretary Carter, General Dunford, Mrs. Dunford, Ellen, thanks for coming. Thanks for being here. Gentlemen, thank you for being here, and thanks for your kind words. I am humbled by your words. But most important, thanks for the strong support that you have consistently shown to me and to this great command. You have championed our efforts at the highest levels of government. You have made sure that we had the necessary resources to accomplish the mission that we were given. And you have celebrated whatever successes that we have achieved. We are truly grateful for your tremendous support. To the distinguished guests in the audience, and there are many here today, far too many to mention each by name. However, I do want to thank you all for coming. Many of you are members of the wonderful Greater Tampa community, and you should know that we consider you to be family. Others have traveled long distances, and we appreciate you being here as well. You too are family. And I want to take this opportunity to thank you for the strong support that you continue to show to this command and to the men and women in uniform, our civilians, and their families. We are very fortunate here at Central Command to have many coalition partners represented. The region and the international community writ large typically send us their very best officers. And the capability that they bring to the team is of tremendous value to us. And so, to our partners, you make this outstanding team even better. Thank you for your exceptional contributions, and thanks to your families as well. I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge a few close friends. A number of my high school classmates are in the crowd, and several of my West Point classmates are here as well. And gentlemen, courage and drive, 75, hooah. Most of the troops are saying 75. That was 20 years before I was born. In all seriousness, you should know that your presence and your support mean a great deal to me, so thank you for being here this afternoon. To my battle buddy, Ambassador Jim Jeffrey, Jim and I spent a good bit of time together in Iraq, and Jim, I appreciate your friendship and your strong support and your wise counsel over the years. To my good friends, Lee and Priscilla Cockrell, thanks for being here as well. Lee is a renowned businessman and public speaker, and most important, he and Priscilla are wonderful people. And finally, I'd like to take a moment and extend a very special welcome to my family, some of whom have traveled long distances to be here today, and I'm thankful for them doing so. I'm grateful for their love and their encouragement and for the incredible support that they have shown me throughout my career. I look forward to spending more time with all of you in the coming days. Again, thanks for being here. You've made this a very special event. You know, I've benefited from the support of many people over the course of my career, and I am truly grateful for that support. But that support has paled in comparison to the support that I have received from my biggest cheerleader, my staunchest advocate, and my best friend in the world, and that is my bride, Charlene. Now, Charlene, she's also a pretty good coach. And you guys who have been on sports teams know that the coach doesn't give you good news all the time. Coach tells you like it is from time to time, and so we all need that good coaching. But Charlene reminded me the other day that I've been gone a whole lot of years since 2003 with three tours in Iraq and one in Afghanistan. And I've not been around much since taking command of CENTCOM either, but Char, I want you to know that your love and support has given me tremendous strength. And especially during some really challenging periods, I love you, and I look forward to hanging out with you more in the future, and that all starts today. Now, Char, you know that we have a number of awards to give you, and we save those awards for when we have our retirement ceremony next week, and so more is coming. But again, you're a wonderful friend, coach, and confidant, so thanks for all that you've done for me and for this entire team. Ladies and gentlemen, we are in the midst of one of the most tumultuous periods in the history of the Central Region. As you look across that vast expanse, you see unprecedented conflict and turmoil, widespread discord, and tremendous human suffering. However, despite the many challenges present in that part of the world, I do believe that there is cause for optimism. And I am optimistic in part because I have seen this team, United States Central Command, together with our interagency partners and our international community, I have seen this team do amazing things. Indeed, I have seen the men and women of this command perform miracles on a routine basis. You heard the chairman just talk about this a minute ago, but if you consider all that this command has dealt with over the past 3 years, the Egyptian revolution in 2013, President Assad's use of chemical weapons and the removal of the chemical weapons stockpile in 2014, the fall of the city of Mosul in Iraq to the terrorist organization ISIL or Daesh in June of 2014. Soon thereafter, we conducted the very first airdrops of humanitarian aid to the Yazidis trapped atop Sinjar Mountain. We began conducting airstrikes against ISIL positions in the northern part of that country in support of the Kurdish Peshmerga. And we quickly expanded the air campaign into Syria on the night of the 23rd of September, when five Sunni Arab-led nations flew with us in what was truly an unprecedented operation. And since then, our coalition pilots have conducted well over 11,000 strikes in Iraq and Syria in what is the most precise air campaign in history. That same month, in September of 2014, we saw the overthrow of the legitimate government in Yemen. In December, we transitioned from Operation Enduring Freedom to the Resolute Support Mission in Afghanistan. And then, last July, we witnessed the signing of the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action that seeks to prevent Iran from securing a nuclear weapon. I want to thank the great folks in the State Department who are represented here today by Ann Patterson in the crowd somewhere. Thank them for what they have done as well to support our efforts in the region. But the list of activities goes on and on. There have been hostage rescue attempts, embassy evacuations, and counterterrorism strikes. There isn't a more demanding mission in the inventory, in my opinion. And this team, United States Central Command, this team has done an absolutely outstanding job on all accounts. Indeed, the ability of the command to address the vast challenges that are present today throughout our area of responsibility, and to have the kind of impact that the command has had, and the impact has been tremendous, well, that speaks volumes about the quality of people on the team, military, civilian, and contractor.